1947. The British are leaving India. Exhausted by the war, overwhelmed by insurrection, Britain needs an exit strategy. But how do you get out of a subcontinent you've ruled for 150 years? Especially when long-buried arguments burst violently into the open. The man sent to India to close down the British Raj and keep order was Lord Louis Mountbatten. No year of British rule in India would produce more bloodshed than the last.
I am under no illusion about the difficulty of my task. I shall need the greatest goodwill, Charles. I shall need the greatest goodwill of the greatest possible number.
Popinjay?
Yes, but a rather splendid Popinjay.
I think Mountbatten brought with him all the background. I mean, when you think he was 7 years old when he visited the Tsar of Russia, from a small child he'd had this sense of occasion.
War hero and cousin of the king, Lord Mountbatten had liberated Burma from the Japanese. With his wife Edwina, the millionairess who had once blazed in London society, the Mountbattens were a striking choice to end British rule in India.
We had this tremendous feeling that they would work in tandem. You had this feeling that they were a couple.
In March 1947, the couple arrived in Delhi with a reputation for speed of action and a most un-British sympathy for Indian independence.
I think everyone felt this is it. I think there was a tremendous sense that this is the beginning of something which is going to be successful.
British India was a country of 400 million people belonging to many religions. Two groups stood out: the Hindus, who were the clear majority, and the Muslims. For centuries under the British, they lived side by side in peace. Mountbatten's challenge was to end British rule and prepare for a smooth transfer of power to this gigantic and diverse nation. He had just 18 months to complete it.
For the last time in history, a viceroy begins his term of office as Lord Mountbatten takes the oath of allegiance from the Lord Chief Justice of India, Sir Patrick Spence.
This is not a normal viceroyalty on which I am embarking. His Majesty's government is resolved to transfer power by June 1948. Now, this means the solution must be reached within the next few months. I am under no illusion of the difficulty of my task. I shall need the greatest goodwill of the greatest possible number. Today, I am asking India for that goodwill.
The objective was very clearly stated, and it was, in fact, brutally stated. So whatever happens, we leave this country on such and such date.
In a country that's really rather laid back and inert. I mean, none of us had worked that hard. He made his ADCs work, he made his staff work, and the Indian office work. Even the domestic servants had to be on their toes.
People will say that's not the way the last viceroy did things, nor the one before, or the one before that.
Viceroy's door opener, viceroy's chicken plucker, viceroy's cushion puffer.
You see? We need to cut down on stuff.
And the number of banquets. It's quite obscene the way we're expected to gorge ourselves while there's a famine in Bengal.
Thank you.
Yes, I see.
You know, there is much to be said here for continuity.
Oh, I don't think so. I always found continuity to be the most overrated virtue in the Navy.
they were extremely different from people who'd gone before and made a very special effort, I think, to do all this on a basis of friendship and understanding.
I know who I must meet first, Mountbatten told his staff. This was the man previous viceroys had come to see as their most dangerous enemy. Mahatma Gandhi had embraced the poverty of his countrymen and dedicated his life, much of it as a political prisoner, to getting rid of the British. In March 1947, he came to Mountbatten with a vision that Hindus and Muslims would now rule India together.
They said I would find you out here. Edwina Mountbatten.
I could have waited in the cool hall, but I was curious to see your Mughal garden.
It's your garden, Mr. Gandhi. We are merely the trustees.
You know, for the Mughals, the garden was a glimpse of heaven. They drew inspiration from Holy Quran, modifying and adapting what was found to make a paradise on earth. All elements perfectly blended.
The gentlemen of the press are here and would like us to pose for photographs.
Oh, then we must show them our best faces.
The extent of Hindu-Muslim distrust was referred to by Gandhi throughout his life. He called it the question of questions. It's very hard to deal with. But he felt that this was a question that had to be tackled because Hindus and Muslims had to live next to each other. They were neighbors in hundreds of thousands of Indian villages. There was no way out except some kind of coexistence.
Gandhi's commitment to Hindu-Muslim unity was one that Mountbatten shared. But in 1947, that unity was under enormous stress.
That is the time when the Muslims began to fear. They said, as long as the British were here, we were all the same. But now, if this is going to happen and it's going to be a democracy, then we will be a permanent minority. And what protection do we have? At that point, they couldn't trust the Hindu.
The man who took this Muslim fear of the Hindu and made it respectable was Muhammad Ali Jinnah, described to Mountbatten as the most difficult man in India. Jinnah was almost a reverse image of Gandhi. He had embraced a Western lifestyle, and he thought Muslim-Hindu unity to be a fantasy.
We are two nations, Muslim and Hindu. What we have in common is the British yoke. But that is about to be lifted. And then we must go our separate ways. That is why we ask for Pakistan.
Sir, there are some who say you want to create a nation
without ruining the crease in my trousers. Ask me what is it like in a British prison. I couldn't tell you. I would have to refer you to Mr. Gandhi.
Here is a man totally westernized, in Western clothes, and of course he was a tremendous charisma. And all the time, whether he was talking to us or talking to the people, we saw a great lawyer presenting his case.
The partition of India will be done amicably by discussion in an atmosphere of freedom.
The British will not?
The British will accept partition. They always do. It worked in Ireland, it will work in Palestine, it will work here.
Jinnah's radical idea was partition. India's Muslims would be given a state in the northeast and west of the country, in the areas where they already formed a majority. This would be Pakistan. The rest of British India would be left to the Hindus, which Jinnah called Hindustan.
We thought that unless we have our own country, we cannot really have our own government and run the way govern the way we like and live the way we like, because we knew that the British were going. It was a matter of time.
To India's most powerful politician, the idea of a separate Muslim homeland was an abomination. A disciple of Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, the leader of the Congress Party, spoke not of Hindus or Muslims, but simply of Indians. You won't achieve anything, Mountbatten was told, without this man's agreement.
I don't want you to think of me as the last viceroy winding up the British Raj, but as the first to lead the way to the new India. I shall, of course, be speaking to Mr. Jinnah.
Pakistan? Where does this fantastic idea come from? Who knows what it really means? A separate Muslim nation in India is absurd. It's actually medieval. Pakistan. Concoction of Mr. Jinnah and his typewriter.
I don't think Mr. Jinnah could have understood India. It was a cultural unity and had been for thousands of years, a plural society, a place of many religions and languages. All of that had passed him by.
In 1947, Jinnah's ideas had started to take root amongst India's Muslims.
Hindus and Muslims are two separate cultures. They don't pray together. They don't dine together. Their festivals are different. Their cultures are different. Their dresses are different. How could you? You can't amalgamate yourself into their culture or into their habits, as they cannot amalgamate themselves into our culture. They are two different nations.
We were actually the poor people. Masses were poor Muslims. And shopkeepers and bankers and all these, they were Hindus mostly.
By the time Mountbatten arrived in India, the concept of Pakistan had a mass organization behind it, and Mr. Jinnah was riding high. It is clear, Mountbatten wrote, that this is the man who holds the key to the whole situation.
People tell me Pakistan cannot be defined. I hope, Mr. Jinnah, you might help me understand it.
I have written many times on the subject.
Without explaining how this new nation will come about. And where will its borders lie? What will its relationship be to India?
Hindustan.
I beg your pardon.
You said India. It'll be called Hindustan.
At the end of his first week in Delhi, Mountbatten had reached political stalemate. But 200 miles away, a retired schoolteacher called Master Tara Singh changed the terms of the debate completely.
Our lands are about to be overrun. Our women dishonored. Our children forced to take alien vows.
My grandfather got emotional at that point of time, whereas the Muslim League was saying that long live Pakistan, and Masterji raised the slogan of death to Pakistan, because he didn't want Pakistan to come into existence.
I have sounded the bugle. Finish the Muslim League. Death to Pakistan.
Lord Mountbatten, the last viceroy, had just 18 months to end British rule in India. But India was falling apart. Nowhere was the tension greater than in the northern province of the Punjab, with its volatile mix of Muslims, Hindus, and Sikhs. On April 3rd, 1947, a week after Mountbatten arrived in India, His governor in the province, Sir Evan Jenkins, sent a storm signal to the Viceroy.
There is little doubt that some of the Sikh leaders are circulating grossly exaggerated accounts of Muslim atrocities. I pointed this out to one Sikh leader.
This is Master Tara Singh.
Yes, retired school teacher, taken to rattling his kirpan.
I said that propaganda of this kind gave the impression that they were about to attack the Muslims. He laughed heartily at this and said the Sikhs would do no such thing until the British had left India.
Jenkins' telegram made one thing clear to Mountbatten. The question of how to withdraw from India had turned into the question of what to do about the Punjab. The Punjab, with its capital Lahore, was home to 25 million Muslims. If partition happened, Pakistan would be based here. So thought Mr. Jinnah and the Muslim League. But it was the worst place for Jinnah to stake a claim for a Muslim homeland. For the Sikhs saw the Punjab as their home too. Master Tara Singh's incendiary speech had raised the stakes for everybody.
Master Tara Singh had taken out his kirpan, the sword, and he said, this will decide whether the Muslims rule Punjab or the Sikhs rule Punjab. And that was stunning. We were so depressed and upset. Some of, obviously, angry also.
Once Master Tara Singh very clearly came out against partition, then his home district was the first one which was attacked by the Muslim mobs.
We started having these people coming in from the villages with terrible knife wounds. It was mostly Sikhs at that time. And they would walk in from the village to Lahore, and all our hospitals were then full of wounded Sikhs.
With Sikhs and Muslims on the brink of war over partition, Mountbatten again turned to his favorite solution, how to get Jinnah to drop his Pakistan demand. And then Gandhi came forward with a plan to achieve exactly that. A plan that, if Jinnah accepted, would satisfy the Muslim demand for power while not requiring Mountbatten to partition India.
You will be daring?
I intend to be.
Then you should offer the government of India to Mr. Jinnah and the Muslim League.
Mr. Jinnah? As Prime Minister?
He would still be permitted to make his case for Pakistan, so long as he used reasons only, and not force of arms.
What do you think Mr. Jinnah would say to such a proposal?
If you tell him I'm the author, he'll reply, "Wily Gandhi."
And I presume he will be right.
Not at all. I'm sincere. I will travel length and breadth of India to get Hindus to accept Jinnah as their leader.
I doubt that Gandhi would have been devious in making that offer. The offer, the idea, should have been on the table a bit earlier, because by the time Mountbatten came, the idea of the partition had become so much a part of the Muslim League. From a slogan, it had become an article of faith.
Jinnah was brilliant. He was dedicated. He did not feel he could play second fiddle to anybody.
It was Gandhi's idea, wasn't it?
Let's say it's a vision we both share.
You know, it cost a fortune to keep him in such poverty. They say Mr. Jinnah travels first class. It's true, I do. And Mr. Gandhi travels third class? Also true. But everywhere he goes, his code follows. 100 third class tickets? Suddenly, it's Mr. Jinnah who looks abstemious. When he talked to me, know that 80 million Muslims are listening. Gandhi represents no one but himself. Ask him to get his scheme past Nehru and the Congress before you ask me what I think of it.
Jinnah's refusal to accept Gandhi's offer of government stripped Mountbatten of his ace. It left the question of partition in the hands of those on the ground. In the Punjab, armed Sikh militias, stirred up by religious leaders, went on the rampage.
They were killing, looting, and raping the girls. Those killers came from, I don't know from where.
Sikh attacks provoked Muslim reprisals.
Whatever they did was in self-defense. No Muslim, whatever he was, whatever capacity he was, whatever status he was, he didn't do it first. It was them who started.
There was a sort of madness going on. People who lived together, unaware that it mattered at all. You're a Muslim, I'm a Hindu, and you're jogging along together. We're all human beings. And now suddenly we are enemies, such hateful enemies.
It's just piles of body, blood everywhere. The houses were burning, there's acrid smoke everywhere. And women and children crying, those who survived, and the masses of wounded people. It was very difficult to find any hospital to take them in. One saw so much of blood and dead bodies and children being wounded or dead, or parts of people being displayed. All these things hardened one, and one just went on with one's job.
Not all the Punjab massacres were reported in New Delhi, but it was impossible to keep the unfolding nightmare completely at bay.
Well, I mean, people were horrified because, frankly, people hadn't expected an explosion on that scale.
On April the 15th, Mountbatten summoned his provincial governors to the capital to get their advice and to lay down his own strategy.
Creation of Pakistan. I will resist if at all possible, but I do recognize that if India has to be partitioned, then the Punjab and Bengal must be partitioned too.
That will not be an easy thing, not in the Punjab. When Jinnah talks of two nations, it sounds so clean. But announce partition and every village, every field, will provide a source of argument. To keep the peace, I'd need at least 70,000 troops.
Well, you won't get them. We don't have anything like those reserves.
Then we'd have little choice but to get out and leave them to it. The Sikhs will fight. But they'd prefer us to be out of the way first.
And the Muslims?
The Muslim policy is one of daring us to leave.
Typically far-sighted.
Mr. Jinnah has declined my offer to travel to the Punjab to calm the situation.
I don't see what good he could do there. He speaks neither Urdu nor Punjabi, just Chancery Lane English.
Be that as it may, Mr. Jinnah has agreed to issue a statement along with Gandhi calling for peace.
Gandhi's been telling our soldiers in Bengal to meet the knives of the mob with their bare chests.
I personally do not undervalue the Mahatma's contribution. And just in case you think I've been at the ghost herd, I will remind you, gentlemen, I'm a soldier, not a civilian. And if this communal violence gets out of hand, I shall issue military orders. Sikh kirpans, Muslim swords, Hindu, whatever their choice of weapon, shall then contest British Empire aircraft and British Empire tanks.
His very determination defeated his longer-term aim. Mountbatten himself also got hustled into situations by circumstances, to which one contribution was his own element of his own haste.
Everywhere in the Punjab, people were now in fear of their lives. With militias on the loose over much of the province, one half of the population was particularly vulnerable.
Our women cannot go out, we cannot run. They have never been outside their home. And if there is an attack, and if they are abducted, then what we are going to do? What should we do? So they said that they have decided that they will burn their women.
It was the women, both Sikh and Muslim, who suffered most. The dishonor of rape was enough for fathers and brothers to kill their own.
They will put their women in a room, put kerosene oil on them, light them, burn them, and then they will be free to fight with the attackers, and there will be no danger of their women being abducted. I even bought a tin of kerosene oil to burn my sister then. But when I came home from the meeting and saw my nephew and nieces and my sisters, I said, no, I can't do this.
With people being defined by their religion and killed because of it, Gandhi appealed for reason.
You have heard his account, 58 of his companions killed because they were Hindus. And you have heard others call for revenge. It is a human response, but it is a mistake.
We always viewed at such things of Mr. Gandhi as hypocritical. Because at that stage, when things had already been out of your hands, to go ahead and to say we are trying to stop it, I mean, it's just nonsensical. Because you could have avoided it, not to let it happen. Then once it starts, then to move and to say, well, I'm trying to stop it, is just sheer hypocrisy.
I have said many times, an eye for an eye will make the world blind.
He was caught in an impossible contradiction. He could not enlist the Hindus without proclaiming his Hinduness. And he could not proclaim his Hinduness without alienating many Muslims.
With Gandhi out of the equation, Mountbatten turned to the one man who could reach the Muslims. A final attempt was made to seduce Jinnah from the Pakistan demand.
I heard that you used to be an actor, Mr. Jinnah.
No, I used to read Shakespeare to entertain my London friends. News got around, Jinnah reads well. What a piece of work is man.
He didn't seem to fit his cause, as it were. He was not an orthodox Muslim. He was a highly westernized person who lived a very westernized life in a very cosmopolitan city, Bombay.
In apprehension,
all of that didn't fit in with this fanatic outlook that religion was something that decided nationality.
I signed up with a theatre company and I wrote to my father in Bombay to tell him the good news.
How marvelous. He must have been delighted.
Madam, he was not delighted. He wrote back, "Do not be a traitor to the family."
Well, we lost a great actor.
But gained a great statesman.
You know, India has never been a true nation. It only looks that way on the map. You see, the cow I want to eat, the Hindu stops me killing. Every time I shake hands with a Hindu, he has to wash his hands. The only thing we Muslims have in common with the Hindu is our slavery to the British.
No, it's hardly slavery anymore.
And already the violence starts, you see. That is why the map you take back to London will not be of India. but two separate nations, Hindustan and Pakistan.
If I follow your logic and recommend the partition of India, I am bound, am I not, to partition the Punjab too?
Certainly not. Punjab is a unity. It has its own identity, its own history. It has been like this for generations.
So has India.
You cannot split Punjab.
By the same token, you cannot split India.
Pakistan needs Punjab.
And India needs what you call Pakistan.
This is just a game. I cannot play this game.
I assure you, Mr. Jinnah, it is not a game.
With his failure to shift Jinnah even an inch, Mountbatten went to see for himself the area fought over by Muslims, Hindus and Sikhs. In northwest frontier province, he learned the Muslim League had organized a show of strength for Pakistan.
They're Pathan tribesmen mainly. About 100,000, we believe. They're in a pretty ugly mood, sir. What I mean to say is they are armed.
Are you all right, darling?
Ruined. Pulling out the damned ashtrays on that plane.
It was known to be a very menacing visit to go. It was a very brave thing to do, and very sensible to do it right at the beginning, because, I mean, Mountbatten was setting the tone, you see, setting the tone of how things would go forward.
They'll be able to see you from up there, sir.
I'm coming too.
This huge, great, hostile crowd of people, and you know, it was a sense that things would go either way. And they stood there, and they just, well, they just, the whole people just calmed down.
Realized that Jinnah's call for Pakistan was moving millions. The tour of the Punjab had brought home to Mountbatten the depth of religious hatred between Muslim and Sikh. It was, he said, like walking into the middle of a civil war.
At that point of time, it was more a question of survival. Because the Sikhs were a minority then, Sikhs are a minority even now, and for a minority community to survive, it's very difficult.
Partition, the Muslim League policy for India, Mountbatten had opposed. But it now looked like it was happening anyway through the sheer force of violence. If it did happen, Mountbatten knew that he would have to sacrifice the Sikh minority who opposed it.
We will never again be able to live in peace with the Muslim. Not with so many killed in cold blood, or turned at knife point into accepting Islam.
But you will have to live with them unless the Punjab is partitioned.
You must not partition the Punjab. It must remain as the Sikh homeland. Who built the Punjab? Ask your own officers. Who are the best farmers? They will tell you that the Sikhs are the best farmers. Everywhere in this land we have our holy places.
The Sikhs, so proud and so martial and so confident that the British would not let them down, felt betrayed, felt they nothing was there now for them.
According to the census, the Muslims have a majority in Lahore.
Head count. 1, 2, 3, 4. Why count the insects when you can count the horses? We are the horses. ये तर्क सिखा दिए मुसलमाना दी नहीं।
हाँ हाँ, तर्क सिखा दिए मुसलमाना दी।
Think it through here.
There is a saying in this country that the Hindus always see the storm when it is still at a great distance. The Muslim sees it when it comes over him, and the Sikh sees it when it's passed. So apparently they, of course, thought of what should be done after the storm has passed.
It's a revenge attack, apparently.
A hospital?
They are saying the Sikhs started it. They attacked the mosque.
And the children? How can we let this happen? Where are the soldiers?
She had an enormous perceptive grasp of what we were going through. And she knew that the feeling that if you haven't been displaced, you don't really understand this, what it feels like to know that you will never go home again.
Mountbatten's visit to the Punjab had taught him one thing, that the vision of a united India was in tatters.
My God, if it carries on like this, there'll be all out civil war.
Isn't it one already, Dickie?
Astonishingly, Nehru and the Congress Party had come to the same momentous conclusion.
I think there was extreme anguish, extreme sorrow, and sort of feeling of despair almost that this was happening. And at that point, how to stop it.
Surrendering his beloved vision, it was Nehru who now told India that he would accept partition.
For generations, we have dreamt and struggled for a free, independent, and united India.
3/4 of India was available to them to develop the way they wanted. So they finally saw virtue in the plan that they earlier had opposed so much.
It is painful for any of us to contemplate partition, but we recognize that a united India cannot be based on compulsion. The India of geography, of history and tradition, the India of our minds and hearts cannot change.
With Nehru agreed to partition and the creation of Pakistan, Mountbatten returned to London to get the policy approved by the British government. On achieving this, his final hurdle was to get Jinnah to accept that Pakistan would only get half of the Punjab.
You have what you want, Mr. Jinnah.
And Punjab?
I don't think Nehru will give you that.
The Muslim League will never accept a Pakistan without Punjab.
Yes, I read your article in the newspaper.
All of it.
Good tactics to retreat while sounding the charge. Because retreat you must, and then everybody can start to compromise.
Leave me with a moth-eaten Pakistan.
There is still time to stop me recommending partition, Mr. Jinnah. No need to divide the Punjab. No need to reduce Lahore. Guarantees for the Muslim people built into the constitution. You, a father of that constitution. India, unpartitioned with its united army and navy. We're talking about what would surely be the greatest power in Asia.
You are talking about it, not me.
He was a superb tactician. Of course, helped a great deal by his knowledge that Britain is in a hurry. Therefore, now is the time to strike a deal.
On June the 3rd, Mountbatten gathered the Indian leaders for one last push.
Dickie would like to invite the photographers in before you begin.
Of course. Yeah. Tell me? Yes.
I think we should get ready.
What he needed from them all was both an agreement to partition India and an agreement to split the Punjab between them. Most importantly, they needed to agree to this in front of each other.
The decisions we make this morning will affect one-fifth of the human race. And for that reason, we must put our vanities and our appetites to one side. I would raise the possibility, even now, of the prospect of a united India. If I thought it had the slightest possible chance of being accepted. And so consequently, we must turn our minds to how best we divide this great nation.
Jinnah wanted Pakistan and Nehru wanted independence, and Lord Mountbatten wanted to get the job done. That was his primary concern. That's what he came out to do, and that's what he did.
And this is the plan agreed by His Majesty's government in London 2 days ago.
How do you separate all the Muslims in India into another state? Muslims are all over India. We have a huge Muslim population who have lived thousands of years in every part of India. So did they want all these people to move into another region?
A corridor?
A corridor.
From where exactly?
Calcutta to Lahore.
If you are given Calcutta, if you are given Lahore!
Hindustan can tolerate a narrow corridor.
Hindustan? Hindustan? India!
You're not India.
We are India. It is you who choose to secede from it.
I'm not seceding from anyone. The British are granting independence to two separate nations, Pakistan and Hindustan.
India!
Gentlemen! Gentlemen, this is not the House of Commons. I will not continue until I see a row of smiling faces in front of me. As the Mahatma says, happy is the country with no history. It is not the past, but the future we must contend with.
Railway stock, the army, the air force, the civil service, libraries and art collections, and the national debt, all to be divided between the two new nations.
These are merely the guidelines. All I require now is for your agreement to the basic principle, to partition India.
Well, I speak for the Congress. Although we have points of detail and there could be others, you have our assent.
Mr. Singh, will you agree on behalf of the Sikhs?
Aye, sir.
Mr. Jinnah.
I must first consult with my executive committee.
Mr. Jinnah, if you delay, then the Hindus and Sikhs will delay and chaos will follow.
That is not my responsibility.
Then it is mine.
I cannot accept.
Then I will accept for you. All I need is for you to nod your head. Thank you.
The June the 3rd meeting was a triumph for Mountbatten. Nehru had agreed to partition India, Jinnah to partition the Punjab. Now there was only one man in the way.
Gandhi went on saying he didn't believe that the partition was a good idea. But I think he realized somewhere in the summer of 47 that he wasn't able, not going to be able to hold out, so he retreated into silence.
But I have taken a vow of silence.
Ah.
But you can still talk to me.
I want to say how sorry I am it has come to this, but ultimately it is impossible to enforce a united India against the will of any one community. I hope that when it is announced, you can give your blessing to partition.
Have I said one word against you in my speeches?
No, I don't believe you have.
I do not need to give my blessing. But I will not oppose you.
Thank you.
I could see his anguish. But then anguish was not his constant emotion. He was cracking jokes. He was laughing. He had that capacity to absorb deep agony and summon some great reserves of resources in himself.
With the road now clear, Mountbatten slammed his foot down. To the amazement of everybody, he announced that Britain would leave India 10 months ahead of schedule, on August the 15th, 1947.
I said, why did you do that? Because we were caught unprepared. He said he couldn't hold the country together, so he had to do it.
It did seem that haste overpowered his judgment, because I think the hastening of the date created problems which might have been less severe if it had not been a case of tearing a date off his calendar.
In June, the process of splitting India's assets in two began, an heroic task made into a desperate one by Mountbatten's new deadline. Everything from library books to infrastructure was divided. Men of the same battalion had to choose which country to serve.
The cadets were given an option. Those who wished to migrate to Pakistan could do so, and those who wanted to remain in India could give their certificate accordingly.
We were 66, including some Christian colleagues who had opted for Pakistan. And even then we were told, you can still change your mind. If you wish to stay here, if you want to go, you go.
India. Pakistan. 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 India, Pakistan.
The battalion commanders or the company commanders, they were there, and they said, gentlemen, I'm sorry to inform you that those cadets who had opted for Pakistan, they are supposed to leave tonight.
India.
Parting was very emotional. Very emotional. Except, we didn't cry loudly, but our hearts were aching. And the same was the other side.
Where was the other side? To answer that question, Mountbatten was supplied with a civil servant who would draw the line between India and Pakistan, Sir Cyril Radcliffe.
I'm very keen to see Shimla and the old English churches there. There's a quite magnificent Anglican altar. Very similar to Bath, I'm told.
Yes, Shimla is very lovely.
The streets are named after British mountains, you know. Snowdon, Ben Nevis and so on.
Yes, and you can see the Himalayas in the distance.
It's where Kipling learned to write, Shimla. Very much looking forward to seeing it.
I think it's quite difficult to get someone prepared to take it on, because, I mean, you know, no thanks really, nothing but brickbats, don't you think?
Cyril, is this really your first time in India?
Never before been east of Gibraltar.
Radcliffe had just 36 days to divide the subcontinent. India, 1947. 6 weeks to go before independence, 6 weeks to go before the creation of Pakistan. The man charged with drawing the borderline between the two new states was Sir Cyril Radcliffe.
He was actually put into some house all by himself. No one was allowed to speak to him, in case we had to be clear that nobody had influenced him.
Radcliffe had just 36 days to divide India.
So I asked him, how did you really go about this thing? He said he had no time. So he had to do it in a hurry.
Radcliffe's line through the Punjab would decide which cities, villages and religious shrines would belong to India and which to Pakistan. He drew it knowing a civil war was already raging.
We are very slightly changed from the semi-apes who ranged India's prehistoric clay. But he that drew the longest bow ran his brother down, you know, as we run men down today. Kipling, Rudyard Kipling, the poet?
The uncertainty over where the line would fall was creating panic, especially in the disputed city of Lahore.
We thought Lahore would be on the Indian side because the majority of people in Lahore were Hindus who owned urban property, whereas most of the Punjab, of course, was Muslim. But they were landed people, and the urban people, which was Lahore, we were quite sure would come to the Indian side of the border.
We got scared about this partition part because we didn't know what it meant, what will happen. Will we be separated from our friends forever? And that is very important for all of us, that, you know, they will be, imagine Lahore without Sikhs, imagine Lahore without our Hindu friends, imagine this thing becoming only Muslim. So it was a bit frightening.
Across the Punjab, thousands were now making their own guesses as to where India might end and Pakistan start. Muslims heading in one direction, Hindus and Sikhs in the other.
Each train would take 1,000 persons, and I made certain they went by villages, so everybody knew everybody, and that worked quite well. But the problems, of course, were the attacks on the trains as they went through the countryside.
Armed vigilantes were ambushing trains and slaughtering passengers on the basis of religion.
Many people from the villages, they came out with axes and big knives, because the Hindus and Sikhs, most of the Hindus and Sikhs were traveling on them. And they killed most of them. They killed them. But we were wearing burqas, they knew we were Muslims. So they spared us.
We're producing a fearful butcher's bill, Mountbatten was told by his governor in the Punjab, Evan Jenkins.
There must be someone there trying to steady things.
A train came into Lahore station this morning. 1,000 Muslim passengers. The only man alive was the engineer. You can't keep that secret.
What's the situation with our own people?
The Europeans. We're the untouchables.
Is there anything I can do to help you?
I need to know where Radcliffe's frontier will fall. What's Lahore? Are we in India or are we in Pakistan?
I don't know.
Cyril won't report until after the transfer of power.
I'm sorry. Goodbye.
Dead bodies came in that train. It was just the driver left to drive them. And anyone who happened to survive because he fell under somebody and crawled out afterwards. Carriage after carriage after carriage of dead bodies on either side.
Private armies of religious fanatics now set about cleansing Lahore of their enemies.
We used to climb up onto the second floor
and we could see the city burning. The inside city, the old city. I can still cry.
Order had collapsed in the city. Even the police were fighting each other.
We did not know what was happening for nearly 2 months. And every night we thought this might be the last night of our existence.
Ye musalman tumhare ghar, tumhari dharti aur tumhari zindagi loot lenge. Uthaiye mashal aur inke ghar.
They killed 65 members of my family one day. No fault. No fault of ours. My mother was killed. My father was killed. My two sisters, three sisters, two brothers, my grandfather, my grandmother, grandmother on the maternal side, her daughters, her children, every one of them was killed. No fault.
I'm sorry, but the boundary force is not the solution.
In Delhi, it seemed to both Nehru and Jinnah that the British authorities had stopped even trying to govern.
You're telling me that the men who defeated the Wehrmacht now find a Punjabi rabble too hot to handle?
Why can't you maintain control? It's proving all too easy to set fire to a Punjab village. Narrow alleys, wooden structures, abundant arsonists, not to mention the moral incendiaries.
Excellency, if you will not allow us to govern, then you must take a firmer grip yourself.
One thing you could do, both of you, is to make some concessions to calm people. Could Congress waive its claim to Lahore?
What do you mean?
The signs are that Sir Cyril will award Lahore to Pakistan. Beat him to it. Gain the goodwill.
You have a direct line to Ratcliffe?
Oh, of course he doesn't.
You should declare martial law.
He can't do that.
Well, you could. When it was in Britain's interest to do so.
That is unfair.
I don't care whether you shoot Muslims or not. This must be stopped.
Do you think the police are obeying me? They all know that in 10 days' time I will be gone. I have policemen hiding in their own cells to protect themselves. Others who are only too happy to run with the mob. The Punjab police is no more. People aren't waiting for Radcliffe to report. They're drawing the boundary line for themselves.
With less than 10 days to go to partition, the capital, Delhi, was hit by the mobs. As with the Punjab, the police seem to have gone.
I blame the British also because they were in command. They had all the positions of command at the time, through 1946-47. And had they had the will to do so, they could have put down rioting.
They thought we are leaving anyway. So let them have fun, let them kill them each other. We tried to unify the country, we kept this country together. We gave them law, we gave them culture, we gave them modern education. And now, of course, they are fighting, they are at throats of one another. Let them fight it out.
You ruled the country for such a long time. You had some obligation to help us out.
Who would have thought? We found this place in a mess, and we're leaving it in a mess.
Don't be like that, darling.
Maybe it's true. Without us, the Indians go to seed.
You know that's nonsense.
Well, have they learned nothing from us?
I am eternally surprised they can even begin to forgive us.
But it's very easy for all of us to say the British has to be blamed. But not necessarily. I'm sorry, I don't fully agree with that. I might say that they were careless in not bothering what was going to happen to us afterwards. But all these killings took place because of our own fault and our own feelings and our own inhibitions.
And we must also recognize not only what the Congress did or did not do, not only what Gandhi did or did not do, not only what the British did and did not do, but what the Hindu extremists and what the Muslim extremists did right from the 20s, systematic dissemination of venom and poison.
With less than a week to go to partition, a tidal wave of refugees from the Punjab broke on Delhi itself.
I don't think that Mr. Nehru ever thought there would be the kind of massacre that ensued. And Mountbatten listened to him. I don't blame him. You listen to the people of the country.
To Nehru, who long ago had imagined the triumphal scenes accompanying independence, the catastrophe came at a personal cost.
I'm fairly thick-skinned, but I'm finding this more than I can bear.
During the war, I remember, at a morgue, they lined the dead up in rows, just like pheasants.
It's not the dead. It's the savages that kill them. They're worse than animals. I think I'm losing faith in my own people.
She was well aware of the tragedy that had befallen. 750,000 people had died. And many millions had been displaced. And she knew that, and she never stopped working on that.
The scale of the tragedy was also acknowledged by Mr. Jinnah.
I hope you're not blaming me for that.
Well, I can't help thinking of your two nations theory.
I said only what was already on the mind of Congress.
I'm not sure if Nehru or Gandhi would agree with that.
Let me ask you, who first brought religion into Indian politics? Who inflamed the masses of this country? You must remember, they did. Well, now we see those masses are human beings, not saints.
Mr. Jinnah had come from a very sophisticated Bombay society. Well, they were sophisticated people. They talked of law and order and this and that. But the real people, they were partitioned. Their hearts were partitioned. Their minds were partitioned.
Perhaps only Gandhi, now fasting for peace, understood what had happened.
I remember your beautiful words when we first met in the garden, how everything had been blended to perfection.
That was a garden, not a wilderness. Took skill and devotion and love. It's I who am fasting, not you. Please.
I want you to know that we wholeheartedly support what you are doing.
God is humbling my pride. I am being severely tested. Still, my heart is full of joy.
He was a realist. His fasts unto death were always meant to influence people who loved him. The Pakistan demand was voiced by Muslims who at that time did not love him. They distrusted him. There was no way in which a fast unto death, resulting in his death, would have averted Pakistan.
On August the 14th, Pakistan, the world's first Islamic state, came into existence. In just 10 years, Mr. Jinnah had taken the fanciful idea of a Muslim homeland and turned it into a nation.
It was a happy day. We had attained whatever we wanted, you see.
Twelve hours later, India followed to become the world's largest democracy. On August the 15th, Jawaharlal Nehru made his first speech as Prime Minister at the stroke of midnight.
Long years ago, we made a tryst with destiny. And now the time comes when we shall redeem our pledge, not wholly or in full measure, but very substantially. At the stroke of the midnight hour, when the world sleeps, India will awake to life and freedom. A moment comes which comes but rarely in history, when we step out from the old to the new, when an age ends, and when the soul of a nation long suppressed finds utterance. We are a free and sovereign people today and have rid ourselves of the burden of the past. We look at the world with clear and friendly eyes and at the future with faith and confidence.
Lahore is empty, half empty. The buildings are burning. So this sort of freedom I didn't visualize. Maybe the others did, and they didn't mind. But I didn't feel the freedom at all.
British rule ended in India on August the 15th, 1947.
There was this wonderful feeling, you know, I was not born free. And for me to realize suddenly that now I'm free, it was a very wonderful feeling. And then there was the tragedy that my country, my beloved country, has been partitioned.
But as the last viceroy, Lord Mountbatten, transferred power, the 400 million people of the subcontinent did not know where the borderline was that divided India from the new state of Pakistan. Only after Independence Day was Sir Cyril Radcliffe's award published, a line driven through the Punjab that pleased neither Hindus, Muslims, or Sikhs. Against his instincts, Mountbatten had been forced to split the country in two, but the timetable was his. He failed completely to foresee the human consequences of partition, and failed to prepare for the chaos and upheaval that followed.
The amount of misery in I saw amongst these people who came crying, will my child come? I left my child near such and such place. Will somebody go and fetch that child? I don't know where my husband went. Was he killed? I, as a young woman, thought, no. Why did we do all this and kill each other where we had lived for hundreds and hundreds of years together?
It seemed in the aftermath of independence that the whole of the Punjab had taken to the road looking for safety.
My job was to take an estimated number of 40,000 civilians on foot across 250 miles into Pakistan. The noises the camels were making would be quite extraordinary, the grinding of the wheels and the dust everywhere.
All the time I've seen women with swollen eyes. All the time they were crying. Their children were killed, their brothers were killed, their husbands were killed. I've seen people crying and crying and crying. They were praying and hoping that they should cross the border. They should cross the border. If they cross the border, they will be left alive.
The one and only doctor we had was reporting that he had seen 100 people dying and every day, and between 80 and 100 children dying and being buried as well. It was really a terrible mess. We didn't have time to do anything about it.
A month after independence, Nehru and the Mountbattens took a journey over the Punjab to see the situation for themselves.
The pilot says that this particular caravan is at least 150 miles long.
Which way are they going? I can't tell. Can you?
To Pakistan.
There's another coming the other way. Can you see?
Yes.
Now, darling, can you see the caravans? They're going to meet.
God help us.
This shouldn't be happening. Not like this.
£20 million people were displaced by partition, never to see home again. 1 million died because they belonged to the wrong group.
We'd grown up in India. This was one country. Even today, when I think of Bangladesh or Pakistan, I think of all of us as one culturally.
I wouldn't have mind if I had been killed, because there were survivors, my survivors. They would think that I'm a martyr. Those who have gone are martyrs. They died for a cause.
It happens in history, it has happened. But not like this. Not like this. The suffering was too much. This is killing was too much.
For years, 1947 was seen as a strange eruption of medieval barbarism into the modern world, where neighbor killed neighbor. But now, partition and the primitive sectarian violence it caused seem less a relic of the past than a premonition of wars that were to come.
It is the feeling of emptiness without the other communities being there, because all our lives we lived in those communities. That was the feeling. And that was my feeling, age 17.
This is the man who holds the key to the whole situation.
People tell me Pakistan cannot be defined. I hope, Mr. Jinnah, you might help me understand it.
I have written many times on the subject.
Without explaining how this new nation will come about. And where will its borders lie? What will its relationship be to India?
Hindustan.
I beg your pardon.
You said India. It'll be called Hindustan.
At the end of his first week in Delhi, Mountbatten had reached political stalemate. But 200 miles away, a retired schoolteacher called Master Tara Singh changed the terms of the debate completely.
Our lands are about to be overrun. Our women dishonored. Our children forced to take alien vows.
My grandfather got emotional at that point of time. Whereas the Muslim League was saying that long live Pakistan, and Masterji raised the slogan of death to Pakistan, because he didn't want Pakistan to come into existence.
I have sounded the bugle. Finish the Muslim League. Death to Pakistan!
Lord Mountbatten, the last viceroy, had just 18 months to end British rule in India. But India was falling apart. Nowhere was the tension greater than in the northern province of the Punjab, with its volatile mix of Muslims, Hindus, and Sikhs. On April the 3rd, 1947, a week after Mountbatten arrived in India, his governor in the province, Sir Evan Jenkins, sent a storm signal to the viceroy.
There is little doubt that some of the Sikh leaders are circulating grossly exaggerated accounts of Muslim atrocities. I pointed this out to one Sikh leader.
This is Master Tara Singh.
Yes, retired school teacher,
taken to rattling his kirpan. I said that propaganda of this kind gave the impression that they were about to attack the Muslims. He laughed heartily at this and said the Sikhs would do no such thing until the British had left India.
Jenkins' telegram made one thing clear to Mountbatten. The question of how to withdraw from India had turned into the question of what to do about the Punjab. The Punjab, with its capital Lahore, was home to 25 million Muslims. If partition happened, Pakistan would be based here. So thought Mr. Jinnah and the Muslim League. But it was the worst place for Jinnah to stake a claim for a Muslim homeland. for the Sikhs saw the Punjab as their home too. Master Tara Singh's incendiary speech had raised the stakes for everybody.
Master Tara Singh had taken out his kirpan, the sword, and he said, this will decide whether the Muslims rule Punjab or the Sikhs rule Punjab. And that was stunning. We were so depressed and upset. Some of, obviously, angry also.
Once Master Tara Singh very clearly came out against partition, then his home district was the first one which was attacked by the Muslim mobs.
We started having these people coming in from the villages with terrible knife wounds. It was mostly Sikhs at that time. And they would walk in from the village to Lahore, and all our hospitals were then full of wounded Sikhs.
With Sikhs and Muslims on the brink of war over partition, Mountbatten again turned to his favorite solution, how to get Jinnah to drop his Pakistan demand. And then Gandhi came forward with a plan to achieve exactly that. A plan that, if Jinnah accepted, would satisfy the Muslim demand for power while not requiring Mountbatten to partition India.
You will be daring?
I intend.
Then you should offer the government of India to Mr. Jinnah and the Muslim League.
Mr. Jinnah? As Prime Minister?
He would still be permitted to make his case for Pakistan, so long as he used reasons only, and not force of arms.
What do you think Mr. Jinnah would say to such a proposal?
If you tell him I'm the author, he'll reply, "Wily Gandhi."
And I presume he will be right.
Not at all. I'm sincere. I will travel length and breadth of India to get Hindus to accept Jinnah as their leader.
I doubt that Gandhi would have been devious in making that offer. The offer, the idea, should have been on the table a bit earlier, because by the time Mountbatten came, the idea of the partition had become so much a part of the Muslim League. From a slogan, it had become an article of faith.
Jinnah was brilliant. He was dedicated. He did not feel he could play second fiddle to anybody.
It was Gandhi's idea, wasn't it?
Let's say it's a vision we both share.
You know, it cost a fortune to keep him in such poverty. They say Mr. Jinnah travels first class. It's true, I do. And Mr. Gandhi travels third class? Also true. But everywhere he goes, his code follows. 100 third class tickets? Suddenly, it's Mr. Jinnah who looks abstemious. When he talked to me, know that 80 million Muslims are listening. Gandhi represents no one but himself. Ask him to get a scheme past Nehru and the Congress before you ask me what I think of it.
Jinnah's refusal to accept Gandhi's offer of government stripped Mountbatten of his ace. It left the question of partition in the hands of those on the ground. In the Punjab, armed Sikh militias, stirred up by religious leaders, went on the rampage.
They were killing, looting, and Ripping the girls. Those killers came from, I don't know from where.
Sikh attacks provoked Muslim reprisals.
Whatever they did was in self-defense. No Muslim
whatever he was, whatever capacity he was, whatever status he was, he didn't do it first. It was them who started.
There was a sort of madness going on. People who lived together, unaware that it mattered at all. You're a Muslim, I'm a Hindu, and you're jogging along together. We're all human beings. And now suddenly we are enemies, such hateful enemies.
It's just piles of body, blood everywhere. The houses were burning, there's acrid smoke everywhere. And women and children crying, those who survived, and the masses of wounded people. It was very difficult to find any hospital to take them in. One saw so much of blood and dead bodies and children being wounded or dead, or parts of people being displayed. All these things hardened one, and one just went on with one's job.
Not all the Punjab massacres were reported in New Delhi, but it was impossible to keep the unfolding nightmare completely at bay.
Well, I mean, people were horrified because, frankly, people hadn't expected an explosion on that scale.
On April the 15th, Mountbatten summoned his provincial governors to the capital to get their advice and to lay down his own strategy.
Creation of Pakistan. I will resist if at all possible, but I do recognize that if India has to be partitioned, then the Punjab and Bengal must be partitioned too.
That will not be an easy thing. Not in the Punjab. When Jinnah talks of two nations, it sounds so clean. But announce partition and every village, every field, will provide a source of argument. To keep the peace, I'd need at least 70,000 troops.
Well, you won't get them. We don't have anything like those reserves.
Then we'd have little choice but to get out and leave them to it. The Sikhs will fight, but they'd prefer us to be out of the way first.
And the Muslims?
The Muslim policy is one of daring us to leave.
Typically far-sighted.
Mr. Jinnah has declined my offer to travel to the Punjab to calm the situation.
I don't see what good he could do there. He speaks neither Urdu nor Punjabi, just Chancery Lane English.
Be that as it may, Mr. Jinnah has agreed to issue a statement along with Gandhi calling for peace.
Gandhi's been telling our soldiers in Bengal to meet the knives of the mob with their bare chests.
I personally do not undervalue the Mahatma's contribution.
And just in case you think I've been at the goat's curd, I will remind you, gentlemen, I'm a soldier, not a civilian. And if this communal violence gets out of hand, I shall issue military orders. Sikh kirpans, Muslim swords, Hindu, whatever their choice of weapon, shall then contest British Empire aircraft and British Empire tanks.
His very determination defeated his longer-term aim. Mountbatten himself also got hustled into situations by circumstances, to which one contribution was his own element of his own haste.
Everywhere in the Punjab, people were now in fear of their lives. With militias on the loose over much of the province, one half of the population was particularly vulnerable.
Our women cannot go out, we cannot run. They have not been, never been outside their home. And if there is an attack, and if they are abducted, then what we are going to do? What should we do? So they said that they have decided that they will burn their women.
It was the women, both Sikh and Muslim, who suffered most. The dishonor of rape was enough for fathers and brothers to kill their own.
They will put their women in a room, put kerosene oil on them, light them, burn them, and then they will be free to fight with the attackers, and there will be no danger of their women being abducted. I even bought a tin of kerosene oil to burn my sister then. But when I came home from the meeting and saw my nephew and nieces and my sisters, I said, no, I can't do this.
With people being defined by their religion and killed because of it, Gandhi appealed for reason.
You have heard his account. 58 of his companions killed because they were Hindus. And you have heard others call for revenge. It is a human response.
But it is a mistake.
We always viewed at such things of Mr. Gandhi as hypocritical. Because at that stage, when things had already been out of your hands, to go ahead and to say we are trying to stop it, I mean, it's just nonsensical. Because you could have avoided it, not to let it happen. Then once it starts, then to move and to say, well, I'm trying to stop it, is just sheer hypocrisy.
I have said many times, an eye for an eye will make the world blind.
He was caught in an impossible contradiction. He could not enlist the Hindus without proclaiming his Hinduness. And he could not proclaim his Hinduness without alienating many Muslims.
With Gandhi out of the equation, Mountbatten turned to the one man who could reach the Muslims. A final attempt was made to seduce Jinnah from the Pakistan demand.
I heard that you used to be an actor, Mr. Jinnah.
No, I used to read Shakespeare to entertain my London friends. News got around, Jinnah reads well. What a piece of work is man.
He didn't seem to fit his cause, as it were. He was not an orthodox Muslim. He was a highly westernized person who lived a very westernized life in a very cosmopolitan city, Bombay.
In apprehension, like a god.
All of that didn't fit in with this fanatic outlook that religion was something that decided nationality.
I signed up with a theater company and I wrote to my father in Bombay to tell him the good news.
How marvelous. He must have been delighted.
Madam, he was not delighted. He wrote back, do not be a traitor to the family.
Well, we lost a great actor.
But gained a great statesman.
You know, India has never been a true nation. It only looks that way on the map. You see, the cow I want to eat, the Hindu stops me killing. Every time I shake hands with a Hindu, he has to wash his hands. The only thing we Muslims have in common with the Hindu is our slavery to the British.
No, it's hardly slavery anymore.
And already the violence starts, you see. That is why the map you take back to London will not be of India, but two separate nations, Hindustan and Pakistan.
If I follow your logic and recommend the partition of India, I am bound, am I not, to partition the Punjab too?
Certainly not. Punjab is a unity. It has its own identity, its own history. It has been like this for generations.
So has India.
You cannot split Punjab.
By the same token, you cannot split India.
Pakistan needs Punjab.
And India needs what you call Pakistan.
This is just a game. I cannot play this game.
I assure you, Mr. Jinnah, it is not a game.
With his failure to shift Jinnah even an inch, Mountbatten went to see for himself the area fought over by Muslims, Hindus, and Sikhs. In northwest frontier province, he learned the Muslim League had organized a show of strength for Pakistan.
They're Pathan tribesmen, mainly. About 100,000, we believe. They're in a pretty ugly mood, sir. What I mean to say is they are armed.
Are you all right, darling?
Ruined. Pulling out the damned ashtrays on that plane.
It was known to be a very menacing visit to go. It was a very brave thing to do and very sensible to do it right at the beginning because, I mean, Mountbatten was setting the tone, you see, setting the tone of how things would go forward.
They'll be able to see you from up there, sir.
I'm coming too.
This huge, great, hostile crowd of people, and you know, it was a sense that things would go either way. And they stood there, and they just, well, they just, the whole people just calmed down.
Realized that Jinnah's call for Pakistan was moving millions. The tour of the Punjab had brought home to Mountbatten the depth of religious hatred between Muslim and Sikh. It was, he said, like walking into the middle of a civil war.
At that point of time, it was more a question of survival. Because the Sikhs were a minority then, Sikhs are a minority even now, and for a minority community to survive, it's very difficult.
Partition, the Muslim League policy for India, Mountbatten had opposed. But it now looked like it was happening anyway through the sheer force of violence. If it did happen, Mountbatten knew that he would have to sacrifice the Sikh minority who opposed it.
We will never again be able to live in peace with the Muslim. Not with so many killed in cold blood or turned at knife point into accepting Islam.
But you will have to live with them unless the Punjab is partitioned.
You must not partition the Punjab. It must remain as the Sikh homeland. Who built the Punjab? Ask your own officers. Who are the best farmers? They will tell you that the Sikhs are the best farmers. Everywhere in this land we have our holy places.
The Sikhs, so proud and so martial and so confident that the British would not let them down, felt betrayed, felt they nothing was there now for them.
According to the census, the Muslims have a majority in Lahore.
Head count. 1, 2, 3, 4. Why count the insects when you can count the horses? We are the horses. Ye tart sikha di hai musalmana di nahi.
Ah, tart sikha di hai musalmana di nahi.
Think it through here.
There is a saying in this country that the Hindus always see the storm when it is still at a great distance. The Muslim sees it when it comes over him, and the Sikh sees it when it's passed. So apparently they, of course, thought of what should be done after the storm has passed.
It's a revenge attack, apparently.
A hospital?
They are saying the Sikhs started it. They attacked the mosque.
And the children? How can we let this happen? Where are the soldiers?
She had an enormous perceptive grasp of what we were going through. And she knew that the feeling that if you haven't been displaced, you don't really understand this, what it feels like to know that you will never go home again.
Mountbatten's visit to the Punjab had taught him one thing, that the vision of a united India was in tatters.
My God, if it carries on like this, they'll be all out of civil war.
Isn't it one already, Dickie?
Astonishingly, Nehru and the Congress Party had come to the same momentous conclusion.
I think there was
into some house all by himself. No one was allowed to speak to him in case we had to be clear that nobody had influenced him.
Radcliffe had just 36 days to divide India.
So I asked him, how did you really go about this thing? He said he had no time. So he had to do it in a hurry.
Radcliffe's line through the Punjab would decide which cities, villages and religious shrines would belong to India and which to Pakistan. He drew it knowing a civil war was already raging.
We are very slightly changed from the semi-apes who ranged India's prehistoric clay. But he that drew the longest bow ran his brother down, you know, as we run men down today. Kipling, Rudyard Kipling, the poet?
The uncertainty over where the line would fall was creating panic, especially in the disputed city of Lahore.
We thought Lahore would be on the Indian side, because the majority of people in Lahore were Hindus who owned urban property, whereas most of the Punjab, of course, was Muslim. But they were landed people, and the urban people, which was Lahore, we were quite sure would come to the Indian side of the border.
We got scared about this partition part, because we didn't know what it meant, what will happen. Will we be separated from our friends forever? And that is very important for all of us, that, you know, they will be, imagine Lahore without Sikhs, imagine Lahore without our Hindu friends, imagine this thing becoming only Muslim. So it was a bit frightening.
Across the Punjab, thousands were now making their own guesses as to where India might end and Pakistan start. Muslims heading in one direction, Hindus and Sikhs in the other.
Each train would take 1,000 persons, and I made certain they went by villages, so everybody knew everybody, and that worked quite well. But the problems, of course, were the attacks on the trains as they went through the countryside.
Armed vigilantes were ambushing trains and slaughtering passengers on the basis of religion.
Many people from the villages, they came out with axes and big knives, because the Hindus and Sikhs, most of the Hindus and Sikhs were traveling on them. And they killed most of them. They killed them. But we were wearing burqas, they knew we were Muslims. So they spared us.
We're producing a fearful butcher's bill, Mountbatten was told by his governor in the Punjab, Evan Jenkins.
There must be someone there trying to steady things.
A train came into Lahore station this morning. 1,000 Muslim passengers. The only man alive was the engineer.
You can't keep that secret.
What's the situation with our own people?
The Europeans.
We're the untouchables.
Is there anything I can do to help you?
I need to know where Rackley's frontier will fall. What's Lahore? Are we in India or are we in Pakistan?
I don't know.
Cyril won't report until after the transfer of power.
I'm sorry. Goodbye.
Dead bodies came in that train. It was just the driver left to drive them. And anyone who happened to survive because he fell under somebody and crawled out afterwards. Carriage after carriage after carriage of dead bodies. On either side.
Private armies of religious fanatics now set about cleansing Lahore of their enemies.
We used to climb up onto the second floor. And we could see the city burning. The inside city, the old city. I can still cry.
Order had collapsed in the city. Even the police were fighting each other.
They did not know what was happening for nearly 2 months. And every night we thought this might be the last night of our existence.
Ye musalman tumhare ghar tumhari dharti aur tumhari zindagi loot lenge uthaiye mashal aur inke ghar.
They killed 65 members of my family one day. No fault of ours. My mother was killed. My father was killed. My two sisters, three sisters, two brothers, my grandfather, my grandmother, grandmother on the maternal side, her daughters, her children, every one of them was killed. No fault.
I'm sorry, but the boundary force is not the solution.
In Delhi, it seemed to both Nehru and Jinnah that the British authorities had stopped even trying to govern.
You're telling me that the men who defeated the Wehrmacht now find a Punjabi rabble too hot to handle?
Why can't you maintain control? It's proving all too easy to set fire to a Punjab village. Narrow alleys, wooden structures, abundant arsonists, not to mention the moral incendiaries.
Excellency! If you will not allow us to govern, then you must take a firmer grip yourself.
One thing you could do, both of you, is to make some concessions to calm people. Could Congress waive its claim to Lahore?
What do you mean?
The signs are that Sir Cyril will award Lahore to Pakistan. Beat him to it. Gain the goodwill.
You have a direct line to Radcliffe?
No, of course he doesn't.
You should declare martial law.
He can't do that.
Well, you could. When it was in Britain's interest to do so.
That is unfair.
I don't care whether you shoot Muslims or not. This must be stopped.
Do you think the police are obeying me? They all know that in 10 days' time I will be gone. I have policemen hiding in their own cells to protect themselves. Others who are only too happy to run with the mob. The Punjab police is no more. People aren't waiting for Radcliffe to report. They're drawing the boundary line for themselves.
With less than 10 days to go to partition, the capital, Delhi, was hit by the mobs. As with the Punjab, the police seem to have gone.
I blame the British also because they were in command. They had all the positions of command at the time, through 1946-47. And had they had the will to do so, they could have put down rioting.
They thought we are leaving anyway. So let them have fun, let them kill them, each other. We tried to save, we tried to unify the country, we kept this country together. We gave them law, we gave them culture, we gave them modern education. And now, of course, they are fighting, they are at throats of one another. Let them fight it out.
You ruled the country for such a long time. You had some obligation to help us out.
Who would have thought? We found this place in a mess, and we're leaving it in a mess.
Oh, don't be like that, darling.
Maybe it's true. Without us, the Indians go to seed.
You know that's nonsense.
Well, have they learned nothing from us?
I am eternally surprised they can even begin to forgive us.
Well, it's very easy for all of us to say the British has to be blamed, but not necessarily. I'm sorry, I don't fully agree with that. I might say that they were careless in not bothering what's going to happen to us afterwards. But this, all these killings took place because of our own fault and our own feelings and our own inhibitions.
And we must also recognize not only what the Congress did or did not do, not only what Gandhi did or did not do, not only what the British did and did not do, but what the Hindu extremists and what the Muslim extremists did right from the 20s, systematic dissemination of venom and poison.
With less than a week to go to partition, a tidal wave of refugees from the Punjab broke on Delhi itself.
I don't think that Mr. Nehru ever thought there would be the kind of massacre that ensued. And Mountbatten listened to him. I don't blame him. You listen to the people of the country.
To Nehru, who long ago had imagined the triumphal scenes accompanying independence, the catastrophe came at a personal cost.
I'm fairly thick-skinned, but I'm finding this more than I can bear.
During the war, I remember, at a morgue, they lined the dead up in rows, just like pheasants.
It's not the dead. It's the savages that kill them. They're worse than animals. I think I'm losing faith in my own people.
She was well aware of the tragedy that had befallen. 750,000 people had died. And many millions had been displaced. And she knew that, and she never stopped working on that.
The scale of the tragedy was also acknowledged by Mr. Jinnah.
I hope you're not blaming me for that.
Well, I can't help thinking of your two nations theory.
I said only what was already on the mind of Congress.
I'm not sure if Nehru or Gandhi would agree with that.
Let me ask you, who first brought religion into Indian politics? Who inflamed the masses of this country? You must remember, they did. Well, now we see those masses.
1947. The British are leaving India. Exhausted by the war, overwhelmed by insurrection, Britain needs an exit strategy. But how do you get out of a subcontinent you've ruled for 150 years? Especially when long-buried arguments burst violently into the open. The man sent to India to close down the British Raj and keep order was Lord Louis Mountbatten. No year of British rule in India would produce more bloodshed than the last.
I am under no illusion about the difficulty of my task. I shall need the greatest goodwill, Charles. I shall need the greatest goodwill of the greatest possible number.
Popinjay?
Yes, but a rather splendid Popinjay.
I think Mountbatten brought with him all the background. I mean, when you think he was 7 years old when he visited the Tsar of Russia, from a small child he'd had this sense of occasion.
War hero and cousin of the king, Lord Mountbatten had liberated Burma from the Japanese. With his wife Edwina, the millionaireess who had once blazed in London society, the Mountbattens were a striking choice to end British rule in India.
We had this tremendous feeling that they would work in tandem. You had this feeling that they were a couple.
In March 1947, the couple arrived in Delhi with a reputation for speed of action and a most un-British sympathy for Indian independence.
I think everyone felt this is it. I think there was a tremendous sense that this is the beginning of something which is going to be successful.
British India was a country of 400 million people belonging to many religions. Two groups stood out: the Hindus, who were the clear majority, and the Muslims. For centuries under the British, they lived side by side in peace. Mountbatten's challenge was to end British rule and prepare for a smooth transfer of power to this gigantic and diverse nation. He had just 18 months to complete it.
For the last time in history, a viceroy begins his term of office as Lord Mountbatten takes the oath of allegiance from the Lord Chief Justice of India, Sir Patrick Spence.
This is not a normal viceroyalty on which I am embarking. His Majesty's government is resolved to transfer power by June 1948. Now this means the solution must be reached within the next few months. I am under no illusion of the difficulty of my task. I shall need the greatest goodwill of the greatest possible number. Today, I am asking India for that goodwill.
The objective was very clearly stated, and it was in fact brutally stated. So whatever happens, we leave this country on such and such date.
In a country that's really rather laid back and inert. I mean, none of us had worked that hard. He made his ADCs work, he made his staff work, and the Indian office work. Even the domestic servants had to be on their toes.
People will say that's not the way the last viceroy did things, nor the one before, or the one before that.
Viceroy's door opener, viceroy's chicken plucker, viceroy's cushion puffer.
You see? We need to cut down on staff.
And the number of banquets. It's quite obscene the way we're expected to gorge ourselves while there's a famine in Bengal.
Thank you.
Yes, I see. You know, there is much to be said here for continuity.
Oh, I don't think so. I always found continuity to be the most overrated virtue in the Navy.
They were extremely different from people who'd gone before and made a very special effort, I think, to do all this on a basis of friendship and understanding.
I know who I must meet first, Mountbatten told his staff. This was the man previous viceroys had come to see as their most dangerous enemy. Mahatma Gandhi had embraced the poverty of his countrymen and dedicated his life, much of it as a political prisoner, to getting rid of the British. In March 1947, he came to Mountbatten with a vision that Hindus and Muslims would now rule India together.
They said I would find you out here. Edwina Mountbatten.
I could have waited in the cool hall, but I was curious to see your Mughal garden.
It's your garden, Mr. Gandhi. We are merely the trustees.
You know, for the Mughals, the garden was a glimpse of heaven. They drew inspiration from Holy Quran, modifying and adapting what was found to make a paradise on earth. All elements perfectly blended.
The gentlemen of the press are here and would like us to pose for photographs.
Oh, then we must show them our best faces.
The extent of Hindu-Muslim distrust was referred to by Gandhi throughout his life. He called it the question of questions. It's very hard to deal with. But he felt that this was a question that had to be tackled because Hindus and Muslims had to live next to each other. They were neighbors in hundreds of thousands of Indian villages. There was no way out except some kind of coexistence.
Gandhi's commitment to Hindu-Muslim unity was one that Mountbatten shared. But in 1947, that unity was under enormous stress.
That is the time when the Muslims began to fear. They said, as long as the British were here, we were all the same. But now, if this is going to happen and it's going to be a democracy, then we will be a permanent minority. And what protection do we have? At that point, they couldn't trust the Hindu.
The man who took this Muslim fear of the Hindu and made it respectable was Muhammad Ali Jinnah, described to Mountbatten as the most difficult man in India. Jinnah was almost a reverse image of Gandhi. He had embraced a Western lifestyle, and he thought Muslim-Hindu unity to be a fantasy.
We are two nations, Muslim and Hindu. What we have in common is the British yoke. But that is about to be lifted. And then we must go our separate ways. That is why we ask for Pakistan.
So there are some who say you want to create a nation
without ruining the crease in my trousers. Ask me what is it like in a British prison. I couldn't tell you. I would have to refer you to Mr. Gandhi.
Here is a man totally westernized, in Western clothes, and of course he was a tremendous charisma. And all the time, whether he was talking to us or talking to the people, we saw a great lawyer presenting his case.
The partition of India will be done amicably by discussion in an atmosphere of freezing.
The British will not?
The British will accept partition. They always do. It worked in Ireland, it will work in Palestine, it will work here.
Jinnah's radical idea was partition. India's Muslims would be given a state in the northeast and west of the country, in the areas where they already formed a majority. This would be Pakistan. The rest of British India would be left to the Hindus, which Jinnah called Hindustan.
We thought that unless we have our own country, we cannot really have our own government and run the way govern the way we like and live the way we like, because we knew that the British were going. It was a matter of time.
To India's most powerful politician, the idea of a separate Muslim homeland was an abomination. A disciple of Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, the leader of the Congress Party, spoke not of Hindus or Muslims, but simply of Indians. You won't achieve anything, Mountbatten was told, without this man's agreement.
I don't want you to think of me as the last viceroy winding up the British Raj, but as the first. To lead the way to the new India. I shall, of course, be speaking to Mr. Jinnah.
Pakistan? Where does this fantastic idea come from? Who knows what it really means? A separate Muslim nation in India is absurd. Is actually medieval. Pakistan. Concoction of Mr. Jinnah and his typewriter.
I don't think Mr. Jinnah could have understood India. It was a cultural unity and had been for thousands of years, a plural society, a place of many religions and languages. All of that had passed him by.
In 1947, Jinnah's ideas had started to take root amongst India's Muslims.
Hindus and Muslims are two separate cultures. They don't pray together. They don't dine together. Their festivals are different. Their cultures are different. Their dresses are different. How could you? You can't amalgamate yourself into their culture or into their habits, as they cannot amalgamate themselves into our culture. They are two different nations.
We were actually the poor people. Masses were poor Muslims. And shopkeepers and bankers and all these, they were Hindus mostly.
By the time Mountbatten arrived in India, the concept of Pakistan had a mass organization behind it, and Mr. Jinnah was riding high. It is clear, Mountbatten wrote, that
extreme anguish, extreme sorrow, and sort of feeling of despair almost that this was happening. And at that point, how to stop it.
Surrendering his beloved vision, it was Nehru who now told India that he would accept partition.
For generations, we have dreamt and struggled for a free, independent and united India.
3/4 of India was available to them to develop the way they wanted. So they finally saw virtue in the plan that they earlier had opposed so much.
It is painful for any of us to contemplate partition, but we recognize that a united India cannot be based on compulsion. The India of geography, of history and tradition, the India of our minds and hearts cannot change.
With Nehru agreed to partition and the creation of Pakistan, Mountbatten returned to London to get the policy approved by the British government. On achieving this, his final hurdle was to get Jinnah to accept that Pakistan would only get half of the Punjab.
You have what you want, Mr. Jinnah.
And Punjab?
I don't think Nehru will give you that.
The Muslim League will never accept a Pakistan without Punjab.
Yes, I read your article in the newspaper.
All of it.
It's good tactics to retreat while sounding the charge. Because retreat you must. And then everybody can start to compromise.
Leave me with a moth-eaten Pakistan.
There is still time to stop me recommending partition, Mr. Jinnah. No need to divide the Punjab. No need to reduce Lahore. Guarantees for the Muslim people built into the constitution. You, a father of that constitution. India, unpartitioned with its united army and navy. We're talking about what would surely be the greatest power in Asia.
You're talking about it, not me.
He was a superb tactician. Of course, helped a great deal by his knowledge that Britain is in a hurry. Therefore, now is the time to strike a deal.
On June the 3rd, Mountbatten gathered the Indian leaders for one last push.
Dickie would like to invite the photographers in before you begin.
Of course. Jelly?
Yeah. I think we should get ready.
What he needed from them all was both an agreement to partition India and an agreement to split the Punjab between them. Most importantly, they needed to agree to this in front of each other.
The decisions we make this morning will affect one-fifth of the human race. And for that reason, we must put our vanities and our appetites to one side. I would raise the possibility, even now, of the prospect of a united India. If I thought it had the slightest possible chance of being accepted. And so consequently, we must turn our minds to how best we divide this great nation.
Jinnah wanted Pakistan and Nehru wanted independence, and Lord Mountbatten wanted to get the job done. That was his primary concern. That's what he came out to do, and that's what he did.
And this is the plan agreed by His Majesty's government in London 2 days ago.
How do you separate all the Muslims in India into another state? Muslims are all over India. We have a huge Muslim population who have lived thousands of years in every part of India. So did they want all these people to move into another region?
A corridor?
A corridor.
From where exactly?
Calcutta to Lahore.
If you are given Calcutta, if you are given Lahore!
Hindustan can tolerate a narrow corridor.
Hindustan? Hindustan? India!
You're not India!
We are India! It is you who choose to secede from it!
I'm not seceding from anyone. The British are granting independence to two separate nations, Pakistan and Hindustan!
India!
Gentlemen! Gentlemen, this is not the House of Commons! I will not continue until I see a row of smiling faces in front of me. As the Mahatma says, happy is the country with no history. It is not the past, but the future we must contend with.
Railway stock. The army, the air force, the civil service, libraries and art collections, and the national debt, all to be divided between the two new nations.
These are merely the guidelines. All I require now is for your agreement to the basic principle, to partition India.
Well, I speak for the Congress. Although we have points of detail and there could be others, you have our assent.
Mr. Singh, will you agree on behalf of the Sikhs?
Aye, sir.
Mr. Jinnah.
I must first consult with my executive committee.
Mr. Jinnah, if you delay, then the Hindus and Sikhs will delay and chaos will follow.
That is not my responsibility.
Then it is mine.
I cannot accept.
Then I will accept for you. All I need is for you to nod your head. Thank you.
The June the 3rd meeting was a triumph for Mountbatten. Nehru had agreed to partition India, Jinnah to partition the Punjab. Now there was only one man in the way.
Gandhi went on saying he didn't believe that the partition was a good idea, but I think he realized somewhere in the summer of 47 that he wasn't going to be able to hold out, so he retreated into silence.
But I have taken a vow of silence.
Ah.
But you can still talk to me.
I want to say how sorry I am it has come to this, but ultimately it is impossible to enforce a united India against the will of any one community. I hope that when it is announced, you can give your blessing to partition.
Have I said one word against you in my speeches?
No, I don't believe you have.
I do not need to give my blessing. But I will not oppose you.
Thank you.
I could see his anguish, but then anguish was not his constant emotion. He was cracking jokes, he was laughing. He had that capacity to absorb deep agony and summon some great reserves of resources in himself.
With the road now clear, Mountbatten slammed his foot down. To the amazement of everybody, he announced that Britain would leave India 10 months ahead of schedule on August the 15th, 1947.
I said, why did you do that? Because we were caught unprepared. He said he couldn't hold the country together, so he had to do it.
It did seem that haste overpowered his judgment, because I think the hastening of the date created problems which might have been less severe if it had not been a case of tearing a date off his calendar.
In June, the process of splitting India's assets in two began, an heroic task made into a desperate one by Mountbatten's new deadline. Everything from library books to infrastructure was divided. Men of the same battalion had to choose which country to serve.
The cadets were given an option. Those who wished to migrate to Pakistan could do so, and those who wanted to remain in India could give their certificate accordingly.
We were 66, including some Christian colleagues who had opted for Pakistan. And even then we were told, you can still change your mind. If you wish to stay here, if you want to go, you go.
India. Pakistan. 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 India. Pakistan.
The battalion commanders or the company commanders, they were there. And they said, gentlemen, I'm sorry to inform you that those cadets who had opted for Pakistan, they are supposed to leave tonight.
India.
Parting was very emotional. Very emotional. Except, we didn't cry loudly, but our hearts were aching. And the same was the other side.
Where was the other side? To answer that question, Mountbatten was supplied with a civil servant who would draw the line between India and Pakistan, Sir Cyril Radcliffe.
I'm very keen to see Shimla and the old English churches there. There's a quite magnificent Anglican altar. Very similar to Bath, I'm told.
Yes, Shimla is very lovely.
The streets are named after British mountains, you know. Snowdon, Ben Nevis, and so on.
Yes, and you can see the Himalayas in the distance.
It's where Kipling learned to write, Shimla. Very much looking forward to seeing it.
I think it's quite difficult to get someone prepared to take it on, because, I mean, you know, no thanks really, nothing but brickbats, don't you think?
Sir Cyril, is this really your first time in India?
Never before been east of Gibraltar.
Radcliffe had just 36 days to divide the subcontinent. India, 1947. 6 weeks to go before independence, 6 weeks to go before the creation of Pakistan. The man charged with drawing the borderline between the two new states was Sir Cyril Radcliffe.
He was actually put